So let's put the current industrial revolution, modern human technology into this long-term perspective. With the advent of the industrial revolution in 1850, relying on fossil fuels to generate electricity and power for our machinery, we are now releasing huge quantities of carbon dioxide. We're taking those fossil fuels that were formed over billions of years and now putting them into the atmosphere. What are the likely responses to this global warming? A lot of physiological processes in both plants and animals depend on temperature. Plants do well in a certain temperature range, but in the past, there are parts of the Earth where it was never quite warm enough to be able to be as active as they could be. So you may remember old Jiko. That's the oldest living organism on Earth. It's a Norway spruce that's nearly 10,000 years old. Old Jiko lives in Sweden at a very high latitude, not that far from the Arctic Circle. It's always been so cold up there in the last 10,000 years that Jiko couldn't grow up. So it was a rather low bush that just sort of endured from one year to the next with those very short growing seasons. But in 1915, the climate started changing in Sweden. It started getting warm enough, so now Jiko has grown a trunk. So Jiko is now a tree, a proper tree, after 10,000 years of cold weather. We see a lot of ecological changes that we can attribute to the changing climate. One of the most pervasive is this insect, the mountain pine beetle, very common in the Pacific Northwest of North America. This is in British Columbia. And this brown shows where these pine beetles have been having infestations in the last few years. The climate change has allowed this whole area now is sufficiently warm that the pine beetle has invaded this area from further south. So the geographical range has extended, and it's warm long enough for them to breed several times in a season. And the amount of predation on these trees by the pine beetle has caused huge tracts of forest to die. Dead forests now are releasing yet more carbon dioxide into the air. They're not removing carbon dioxide through photosynthesis. This is another feedback system. And this is happening on a very large scale. The pine beetle is doing this in the Northwest. There are also infestations on the East Coast of the US. In a lot of the milder climates that are becoming warmer, they're being plagued by these insects. Next are evolutionary responses. And we know that with the changing environment, gene frequencies in organisms will also change. As a good example of this, let's look at the pink salmon. We saw how the salmon likes to migrate up into the mountains from the Pacific Ocean. And the timing of migration in the pink salmon has changed in the last few years in response to the changing climate. Temperatures have altered in the Pacific Northwest again, as we've seen. And so now that temperature has increased by several degrees just in the last 40 years. And this is associated now with an earlier migration by the salmon. They can more quickly get ready to make their journey up into the high mountains. And so there's been a more rapid onset of the migration. In the past, it didn't occur until maybe mid-September. Now the salmon are migrating in mid-August. Well, it turns out that the timing of their migration was affected by genetics. There was a particular allele associated with a late migration. And so if we look at the gene frequency, which is on this axis here, through time, those salmon that would migrate in September were very commonly showing a particular gene. And that was true in 1985, 87, and 89. But as the migration shifted to August, their genes are not being represented in future generations. And now that allele is no longer present. It's a very rare allele in the population. There's been gene frequency. So the late migration allele, which used to be at about 10% of the population, has now almost disappeared. just in the last 30 or 40 years. If we look at ecosystems, we're asking what determines the distribution and abundance of species. We've looked at biotic factors. Today we've looked at abiotic factors. Physical, chemical, both influence life on Earth. But we've also seen that life can also influence physical characteristics. Because of photosynthesis, life itself has influenced how much CO2 is in the air, how much nitrogen gets taken up in the soil. Our planet can be viewed as a truly global ecosystem with interacting parts that have, as in total aggregation, an impact on global climate. If we look at where we are and compare our climate and our atmosphere with one of our nearest neighbors, the planet Venus, Venus is a veritable hell. Its atmosphere is 98% carbon dioxide with very little nitrogen. And the temperature on the surface of Venus is 477 degrees Celsius. Our climate is much milder. Our average temperature is 13 degrees Celsius. That's about 50 degrees Fahrenheit. We have less carbon dioxide. We have a lot of nitrogen in the air, and we have 20% oxygen. But if we got rid of life on Earth altogether, we would have the same amount of carbon dioxide and the same low level of nitrogen. Our planet wouldn't be nearly as hot as Venus because we're not as close to the sun, but nothing could live on the Earth under these kinds of conditions. Because of photosynthesis and because of our long history of life taking carbon dioxide out of the air, the temperature has been manageable and our conditions of life have been sustained.